Hello, my fellow parasites.
Parasites? Apologize!
No. Anyway, welcome to Season 4 of the Venom Vlog. This season we'll be covering Venom 2 movie news, more classic Venom and Carnage stories, the Spider-Man Maximum Venom animated series, and all comics involving Eugene Flash Thompson. So sit back and enjoy another exciting episode of the Venom Vlog.
I'm Tom Hardy and you're watching the Venom Vlog. My man
here. Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Venom Vlog. And today we're going to talk about cartoons because obviously Maximum Venom is coming up. And I wanted to kind of dedicate the last few episodes in this one to promoting that show in a way. But this one's going to be a little different. It's not about Maximum Venom per se, but I wanted to talk about Venom and how he appeared in other cartoons outside of the 90s cartoon, because obviously we did those episodes. We talked about him and Carnage and Spider Carnage and the finale of the show. So we've already done all the 90s, you know, cartoons, except now we got to get into the other stuff like Spider-Man Unlimited back there, which I just finished watching a couple hours ago. I just binged the whole season today while I was resting. And I was like, wow, you know, I've never fully remembered this show because when it first aired in 1999, I was on board. Reno Romano does the voice of Peter Parker, Spider-Man, and he also did the voice of the Batman in that cartoon. And my interviews with some of the creators that worked on the Batman cartoon, they're long overdue. I'm sorry. They will be posting up very, very soon. I'm going to try to post them before I move so I can have all that footage out to you guys. But I got to do a really great interview with Sam Liu and Brandon Vietti, who both worked on the Batman. And that's where, you know, Reno Romano did the voice of Batman on that show. So he's Spider-Man in this show. And this is when I first heard of Reno Romano before he went into the Batman. And this show is a very different take on Spider-Man. And I found out why recently. So when the show first started, it was in 1999. They had already made plans to make the live-action Spider-Man movie. So there was like a etiquette put on this show from like Sony and stuff. Like, hey, you can't do the Spider-Man traditional costume for more than like an episode or two. So you got to come up with a new costume for him. You can't do certain things in it. We don't want certain characters to appear more often, like Mary Jane and stuff like that, like because we're going to use her in the movie. So they basically, it was one of those things that you hear about from Warner Brothers sometimes where they go, hey, if like Suicide Squad, we're going to use them in a movie. So Arrow TV show, you can't use them anymore on your show. Like you got to wrap this up and wrap up the Amanda Waller stuff. And we're going to push those characters away because we're going to do live action versions of them now in the, you know, the movie universe and not live action TV anymore. And there sometimes is that mandate where they're like, we got to do this version. We want this to be the definitive version and not this version. And it's ridiculous. Sometimes I think both can exist. People are smart enough to understand that they're two different things. So it's just that kind of mentality. So I think that affected this show and it caused them to change the storyline. So instead of just telling a typical Spider-Man, you know, show and story where he's just swinging around New York fighting crime, he ends up going to a different universe. So it was a lot like a comic book that came out around the same time called Mutant X, which was by Howard Mackey, which is a comic book I really, really love. And the comic was about Havok from the X-Men, Cyclops' brother, going into an alternate universe for like 26 or 32 issues. So just existing outside of the Marvel Universe for a while. And that's what happens here. Spider-Man is trying to track down Venom and Carnage, who are boarding a ship that John Jameson, you know, J. Jonah Jameson's son, he's taking and he's going to fly off into space. And he's going to, you know, I guess they've breached some kind of reality barrier and they're going to, interact with another Earth called Counter-Earth. And so John Jameson is leading the space shuttle to do that. And Venom and Carnage, you know, attack it and they want a board to go over there because they're getting some kind of psychic signal, something called the Simnonic or something like that. And it's like a signal that's coming to them that's telling them that they need to go to this counter Earth. And because it has what they need to, complete a world domination type plan. And so so Spider-Man, of course, goes to intervene to try to stop them. He fails and then the ship kind of crashes and it ends up, of course, on the alternate Earth, but people don't really know. And so they start blaming Spider-Man for the failure and for the ship going down. And they don't know about Venom and Carnage being there. So Spider-Man has to kind of prove his innocence in a way. So he says goodbye to Mary Jane, builds this new suit that he wears in the show, this red thermal, you know, suit with like padding on it and stuff. And then he jumps into this Ender universe and goes after Venom and Carnage. And then when he gets there, he meets the High Evolutionary, who's this guy that sort of reminded me of Null a little bit. The High Evolutionary has like this, you know, cape, this thing that goes down, and he's got like these symbiote tentacle things that come up with teeth on them. like behind his head to kind of look, make him look regal and kind of throne-esque and like a ruler. And I immediately started getting slight, I mean, he doesn't have long hair. He doesn't look like Null that much, but just kind of that chest piece and the shoulder piece and stuff. It kind of gave me that sense of like Null. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. And then also Carnage's design in the show specifically, he's got this tall, lanky, almost look like a Xenomorph from Aliens a little bit. But he's got this tall, lanky look to him with a very thin stomach. And it reminded me a lot of the Absolute Carnage design of the character as well. And so, so of course I was starting to see parallels there. I don't know if, you know, Ryan Stegman or whatever kind of was doing that as a nod to that. But when I was seeing this, you know, cause I don't have a ton of good images of the, of, you know, how Carnage looked in this cartoon, because it's hard to find good high res images and even take some, but you know, just, yeah, when I looked at it, I got vibes like, oh, it looks kind of like Absolute Carnage. So I was wondering maybe Ryan Stegman did that as a nod to that show, as a nod to that version of Carnage, because it is intimidating. It's like a giant, you know, he's, like you said, he's like 8 foot tall and he's kind of hunched over. He's got a very thin waist. He's got, you can see his like rib cage stuff here, like, you know, underneath his chest. And it's pretty menacing looking. He's got little teeth sticking out all over him. And same with Venom. And they have completely new power sets where they can, almost like Venom 2099, where they can completely liquefy themselves, even though they have a human host inside of them, because they've fully now bonded with Cletus Cassidy and Eddie Brock. And so the show doesn't really deal with them a ton. They're kind of in the background for a while in the show. And mainly it's about Spider-Man or Peter ending up on this other Earth and trying to keep a low profile, because Spider-Man's not very liked over here, like with some of the actions he does in the first few episodes. So there's like a woman who runs a clinic and she has a son and her husband is missing. She doesn't really like Spider-Man too much, and she kind of thinks he's a kind of a menace, like J. Jonah Jameson style, but she still runs a clinic and she's trying to help. So Peter Parker decides to help her, you know, complete her mission and try to help people. But hopefully that will link him to Venom and Carnage in some way. So that's kind of the low profile he's keeping. Then, like I said, this Earth is ruled by the High Evolutionary, and he's from the comic books, but and he's met Spider-Man a couple times, I think, too. But in this one, he's got like four generals, like a Ram guy and a Tiger guy and a couple other people. And they're kind of, you know, those are his like his four horsemen, if you will. And they overrule humans. They're like beings that are, you know, animal-like, but they're humanoid looking. So Tiger looks kind of like a tiger, and Ram obviously looks like a ram, but he's human shaped. He's got legs and arms. So he's very humanoid looking, and all of them are. So yeah, there's this, they kind of have like a sports arena where, you know, a Tiger, he's kind of likes humans a little bit more than the others do. The others full on follow their orders from High Evolutionary and kind of chase down and hunt down people and lock them up and detain them and everything like that if they act out of line. So humans are very much oppressed on this planet, and Spider-Man is trying to figure out what Venom and Carnage are doing here. And that leads them to, you know, pretty much like six episodes where you don't really see a lot of Venom and Carnage. But then there's an episode where Eddie Brock does get separated from the suit, which isn't until episode 11. And this is only a 13-episode season. So again, not a ton of Venom in Eddie, and not a ton of Cletus and Carnage in this one. But a little bit in the beginning of the season, and a lot towards the end, because what happens is Eddie gets separated and he's dying. And as he's dying, he befriends the nurse and her son. And I think it's an episode called One's the Loneliest Number, which is an awesome song, by the way. And Eddie is starting to die because he's now been separated from the suit so long, and the suit is dying too. And that kind of reminded me of the movie to an extent, where in the movie, you know, when Eddie and the suit got separated, they both started showing signs of getting worse and more sick. I liked that element here. And then, of course, Eddie at the end does the right thing. He rebonds with the suit when Spider-Man brings it back to him. And you get to see Spider-Man in the black costume again for like a couple, you know, minutes. And then, you know, Eddie rebonds with it and uses it to stop Carnage. And then, of course, the Simnonic thing, whatever is controlling, kind of drawing them, it gets them to stop fighting. And then both Venom. So he was like, I know I'm going to eventually turn on you, Spider-Man, and to this woman and her son. And he's like, I'm sorry, but at least I can maybe get Carnage out of here and we can get away before we both are driven insane to hurt you. So it looks like there's something else in control. And you actually see that. It's almost a little bit like Absolute Carnage in a way, too, where underground, there's like a nest, you know, because like I said, he kind of looks like a Xenomorph, Carnage does. And they're, but Venom still looks like big and bulky. And they're laying these eggs and they're giving birth to like something, like, you know, they're going to bring in new symbiotes or new whatever. And it's part of some big plan. Like I said, they're getting this signal from something that's kind of like telling them to do it. So I don't know what the plan of the show was from there, because the show ends at episode 13 on a cliffhanger where Eddie Brock and Cletus Cassidy get separated one more time from their suits because they rebond at the end of the 11th episode and Spider-Man gets them away. But in doing so, he almost destroys the clinic. So, of course, the woman still hates Spider-Man, and the son is like, no, mom, he tried to help us. And she's like, yeah, but look what he did to our clinic. How are we going to help people now? So Spider-Man is like, all right, he goes to find these people who are leading a revolution. There's like X-51 is on the show, like the Machine Man. Then there's like a Green Goblin who's a hero who may or may not be the husband of this nurse and her son, you know, her father to her son. So there's rumors there, like the inference is there that he could be their father, you know, the father or husband of those two. And then there's also like a Vulture that's a good guy. So there's some like Mutant X. There's some, that comic book had some X-Men that were good guys in this universe, and some that were good guys bad in that universe. Same with this one. It was like sometimes Spider-Man would run across someone he knew in his world, but they're heroes in this one, or villains or whatever. So yeah, it's an interesting show. It's not great. I mean, the animation's okay. The designs, though, are kind of interesting. Like I said, the Carnage one, I'm wondering if it had an impact on Absolute Carnage. Also, they have an underground, you know, beneath the sewers and the subway system. There's, you know, Carnage has a nest, basically, like a xenomorph, and he's like birthing, you know, something. They don't really show what it is, but at the end of the final episode, it has actually Carnage and Venom get separated from their suits one last time and put in containment units. And if that ever happened again, there was a failsafe from the Simnonic thing that was, you know, controlling both of them, that if they ever get separated from their human hosts again, that the nests would just launch. And so these big, like, tentacles come out of the planet and just start shooting those little eggs everywhere, which I'm guessing are full of symbiotes. And it's basically a plan to, you know, consume the world and do a full takeover of the human race on this counter Earth. But what happens, we never know. There was a comic book that kind of tied into the show, but I don't think that ever wrapped up the story either. I think those were just telling stories that were adjacent to the 13 episodes of the show, but I don't think they ever came up with a conclusion of it. I think we do see that Spider-Man again, though, in Spider-Verse, when they did the big crossover in the comic books. They had a version of that Spider-Man. I think he gets killed by Morlin, or, you know, his family or whatever. So yeah, I guess they kind of put a cap on that version in the comic books. But yeah, we never really know what happens in the storyline. And so it's kind of a bummer, you know, because I'm guessing season two would have almost been like a symbiote invasion season. And it looks like we're finally going to get that, though, with Maximum Venom, which is cool. Different version of it, obviously. But seeing this and watching the show again, I was kind of like, you know, this isn't a bad show. I think my initial reaction, because when it came out in 99, they showed like two or three episodes, and then it went off the air. It was destroyed by like Pokemon and Digimon, which were like two of the biggest cartoons at that time, like in 99, 2000. And so it couldn't find a good time slot, and it didn't come back till almost a full year later, at December of 2000. And then it ran until like the spring of 2001. And then the show was just, they just cut it. They were like, you know what, we're going to cut our losses. The movie's, you know, coming out, it's going to do good. And if we do another cartoon, we'll do it in that kind of style or do something else. I think they went on to do like Sensational Spider-Man a couple years later and stuff, which was a great version. I know they did the MTV version first, which was also really good, if you haven't seen that. But there's no Venom in it, so we're not going to talk about it on this show. But Sensational Spider-Man, the next time we talk about animated stuff, we will talk Sensational Spider-Man, because I'm a big fan of Sean Cheeks Galloway, and that was awesome. That was a really great show, and that's kind of what introduced me to him and got me to meet him face-to-face and stuff, and he's just an awesome dude. And we even worked on a project together, which is really cool. So we'll talk about Sensational Spider-Man coming up in a future episode. But for this one, you know, like I said, it ends on a cliffhanger. It looks like an invasion of symbiotes, you know, where Carnage and Venom birthed almost like xenomorphs, all these eggs, and then those eggs get thrown out, you know, by these big tree type tentacle things that come out of the planet. And that's where the season ends, after the High Evolutionary gets defeated. And you find out that the real threat is this Simnonic thing that has been controlling Venom and Carnage the whole time. And then what happens next? I don't know. But your guess is as good as mine. But still, fun thing. Check it out. It's on Disney Plus. Like I said, there it is, Spider-Man Unlimited. And check it out. It's only 13 episodes, and so they're 20 minutes each. You can knock it out in a couple hours, and it's a fun show to binge for sure. And I want to hear your thoughts. If you've seen the show, if you haven't, whatever it is, let me know what your thoughts are down below in the comments. And as always, we'll continue our conversation down there. And like I said, Maximum Venom is starting in April, so I will have more episodes like this that I'll record before I move to Florida, and I'll try to post them up, you know, throughout the rest of the month. And it'll show Venom in other cartoons. And since the movie news is kind of slow right now, we're going to dive back into cartoons, toys, and comic books. So hopefully you guys are okay with that. But I promise once some movie news comes out that is really good concrete information, or a trailer or whatever it is, I will cover it for you. I promise. Thanks so much. See you in the future. Peace.